بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. The topic that we're going to be looking at in the next 6 weeks, inshallah ta'ala, is the final chapter of a very well-known and very useful and beneficial book that's been authored in hadith, authored by Imam al-Hafidh Ahmad ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah ta'ala, who was from the scholars of hadith from Egypt, and he authored many famous books in hadith in particular, and he's one of the leading authorities in hadith. So this book of his, he compiled, and it's called Bulugh al-Maram min Adillati al-Ahkam. Bulugh al-Maram, reaching the heights, min Adillati al-Ahkam, for the evidences of Ahkam. So he listed out around 1,400 ahadith that the scholars have used as evidences for rulings. Okay? Something is halal, something is haram, something is recommended. Where does that come from in our religion? If we say this is haram, or we say this is permissible, it's allowed, or we say you shouldn't do this or you should do that, where do we get that from? The Quran, or the words of the Prophet ﷺ and that which is based on that. Yeah? It's not people coming together and guessing, is it? You don't have a group of men who sit together and think, yeah, this should be halal, this should be haram. That's not how things work. We have a revelation from Allah Ta'ala, the Quran, and we have the teachings of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So he listed and mentioned the ahadith, the words of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that are used as an evidence for these things. Now, we're going to be looking at the last chapter only of this book, because of course 1,400 ahadith is going to take a long time to teach. And we're going to look at the final chapter, which he called Kitab al-Jami', the comprehensive book. He included in it akhlaq and adab and mannerisms and interaction amongst people, how we should interact with each other. And these etiquettes are really, really important. And if a person understands these ahadith, then they will have understood the usul of adab and akhlaq as a Muslim that we should be caring about. And one of the reasons why the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was accepted by people is that his akhlaq were exceptional. In our time in particular, it is more difficult to convince people using words. And the reason for that is, everyone is talking. Everyone has an opinion. And everyone has comments. And you might say something to a person one day, the next day they can watch a YouTube video which says something completely different. And so words, although important and useful, what is just as important is setting an example. Setting an example, especially with people younger than us. Whether parents or teachers, etc. We can sit all day and say, do this, don't do that. Do this, don't do that. This is wrong, this is right. This is wrong, this is right. What students and what children will remember more than just words is a personality. And they will remember character. And this is why I don't remember a single word from what my teachers at primary school told me. But I remember that this teacher had a personality like this, and I used to like that teacher, and I didn't really like that teacher because they were like this, and that teacher was like this. Because you remember personality, and you remember character. And character and setting a good example can have a better impact than just words. And this is why such a chapter is extremely important. Now this chapter is split up into six subheadings. We'll try to look at one heading every week, inshallah ta'ala. And by the end of the 6 weeks, we should have completed this important chapter, which contains more than 100 ahadith. Okay. The first hadith the author mentions, he says, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حق المسلم على المسلم ست. The rights that one Muslim has upon another Muslim are six. This means six things that one Muslim should show another Muslim. قال إذا لقيته فسلم عليه. That's number one. If you meet your Muslim brother or your Muslim sister, then you give them salam. And in a narration in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, وَأَن تُقْرِئَ السَّلَامَ عَلَى مَنْ عَرَفْتَ وَمَنْ لَمْ تَعْرِفْ. And that you should give salam to those who you know and those who you don't know. Because giving salam to the one we know is easy. You're not going to walk past someone who's your friend and just ignore them and not say a single thing to them. That's unlikely. And if someone looked at you and he knows you and he's a friend of yours and just looked at you and walked off without saying salam or saying anything, you would think, what's going on today? So it's easy to give salam to someone who we know. But the one who we don't know, that's where most people lack. Okay, because we think, I don't know you, why do I need to give salam to you? Okay, but the Prophet ﷺ says, the right of a Muslim upon another Muslim is that you give salam. That you give salam to the one who you know and the one who don't. قَالَ وَإِذَا دَعَاكَ فَأَجِبْهُ. And if he invites you, this is the second one, if he invites you, then accept his invitation. He invites you to what? Invites you to his house, invites you for a meal at a restaurant, invites you for a wedding, invites you to attend a aqiqah. What's a aqiqah? Yeah, when a child is born, then it's mustahab to perform a aqiqah with slaughtering meat and inviting other people to eat. So these are the types of invitations that you should accept, if you can. Okay, and the scholars say all invitations should be accepted, they're recommended. It's mustahab to accept all invitations. But the invitation for a wedding, the majority of scholars say accepting it is wajib. It's obligatory, according to most scholars. And that's if the invitation is directly to you. If you receive a direct invitation directed at you as an individual, then unless you have a valid excuse, you should attend. What's a valid excuse? For instance, working. You have work and you're unable to attend. Or for instance, it's in a far place. Sometimes you get an invitation from someone in a different country. And it's not always possible for you to attend. So you give your excuse beforehand and say, I'm not able to attend, unfortunately. And you make dua for that person. How many things have we looked at so far? Two. The third thing he says, وَإِذَا اسْتَنْصَحَكَ فَانْصَحْهُ. And when he asks for advice, then give him sincere advice. Don't give him the wrong advice, or don't give him advice that's going to harm him. And don't give him advice when you don't know what to say. That's part of nasiha as well. Part of giving sincere advice is to only give advice if you know what you're talking about. That's really important. You might like someone a lot and care about them a lot, but if you don't know the proper advice that you should be giving, then don't give advice. Say, I don't know. I don't know, I'll find out for you. Or ask this person, he'll know better than me. That's part of sincere advice. Otherwise, you're going to end up giving advice to someone trying to do good, and instead you end up harming. And this is why to say to someone, I don't know, that's better for them and more sincere from you. And someone came to Malik ibn Anas, rahimahullah. Where was Malik ibn Anas? Where was he living? Huh? He was living in Medina. And someone came to him from Africa. And he said to him, my people have sent me and said that you're the most knowledgeable person on the face of the earth. They've sent me with some questions. So some of the questions he answered and some of the questions he said, I don't know. So the man said to him, if you don't know, then who's going to know? And what, shall I go back all the way to Africa and say to them, I went, but he doesn't know? And it's not like he caught a plane to Medina. He didn't catch a plane to Medina, 6-hour plane, on the same day, plane back. This was walking or riding. And he said to him, when you go back, tell your people, Malik says, I don't know. Because he doesn't know the answer. So how can he give you the answer when he doesn't know? And in another narration, he says, give me a few days and I'll get back to you. After a few days, he said, I don't know. That's more sincere than giving you an answer that's incorrect. And so that's something to note when it comes to giving advice. Don't give advice on something you have no expertise on. And when we ask for advice, we should go to someone who we trust knows what they're talking about. Not anyone. One of the biggest problems is asking for advice from every person that we see on the street. If you have a problem, everyone you see, let me just explain to you my problem, I've got this, what's your advice? You don't ask every person under the sun. You ask the one who can actually provide you some decent advice. Because they are wise, because they're experienced, because they have knowledge of the religion, because they have knowledge of the issue that you want to consult them about, and so on. قَالَ وَإِذَا عَطَصَ فَحَمِدَ اللَّهَ فَشَمِّتْهُ. And if he sneezes and says Alhamdulillah, then you should say Yarhamukallah. Okay, then you should say Yarhamukallah. If a person says Alhamdulillah, then you should say back Yarhamukallah. And not ignore them. Not ignore them. قَالَ وَإِذَا مَرِضَ فَعُدْهُ. And then when he becomes ill, then you should visit him. That's another one of his rights. And that's the fifth right. وَإِذَا مَاتَ فَاتَّبِعُ. And when he passes away, then you should follow his janazah. Pray his janazah. Follow him to the grave when he's being buried, and so on. These are six things. Who can tell me the six things? إِذَا لَقِيتَهُ فَسَلِّمْ عَلِيْهِ. If you meet him, then greet him with salam. وَإِذَا دَعَاكَ فَأَجِبْ. If he invites you, then accept his invitation. هَذِي الْأَخِيرَةِ. وَإِذَا اسْتَنْصَحَكَ فَانْصَحْهُ. If he asks advice, then give him advice if you know. نعم. وَإِذَا عَطَصَ. That's the fourth one. If he sneezes and says Alhamdulillah, فَحَمِدَ اللَّهَ فَشَمِّتْهُ. Fifth. Good. If he falls ill, then meet him. وَإِذَا مَرِضَ فَعُدْهُ. And finally, وَإِذَا مَاتَ فَاتَّبِعْهُ. And if he passes away, then follow his janazah. Reported by Muslim, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. The author says, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, عَنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنَّهُ قَالَ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, انظروا إلى من هو أسفل منكم ولا تنظروا إلى من هو فوقكم. فهو أجدر ألا تزدروا نعمة الله عليكم. متفق عليه. Look at those who are below you, and don't look at those who are higher than you and better off than you, because this will be more likely for you to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this relates to matters of the dunya. When it comes to life, day-to-day issues, look at those who are worse off, not those who are better. Because if you're constantly looking at the one who's better, will you ever appreciate what you have? Never. You'll never appreciate what you have. If everyone here is given £100 each, and one of you is given £5, are you going to appreciate that £5? No, you're going to get angry. Even though it's free, it's a gift, you're still going to get angry. Because you're looking at what everyone else has. But if I give no one anything, and I give you £5, you'll be delighted. Some of you might be delighted, some of you not, maybe not. Why? Because you're not comparing yourself to other people, so you're grateful. Even though if you think about it logically, I've given you £5, what are you complaining about? But you're still not happy. But how can you give everyone else this much? Because you're looking at what other people have. And this is the case with the dunya. He's got a phone, he's got a car, he's got a house, he's got a PlayStation, he's got the latest Arsenal kit. Well, I don't think people are buying Arsenal kits anymore now. He's got the latest this, he's got the latest that. And so what you do have means nothing. Even though we wake up with breakfast and we have food and we eat several times a day and we have a change in clothes and we have a warm house and we have this and we have that. But it means nothing because we're always looking at what someone else has. But when we look at what those who are below us have, we say Alhamdulillah. If you've just gone to visit someone who is poor, whether here or elsewhere, and then you go home and you have a small meal, you'll appreciate that small meal because you have in your mind that person who has nothing. And this is the way that it should be looked at. When we are looking at the matters of the dunya, we have to, as much as possible, remind ourselves to look at those who are below us. And say, Alhamdulillah, there's nothing that we are missing that is worse than everyone on the whole planet. There's always someone who is worse off than us. There are always people who are having it harder than us. And everyone around us has all sorts of different challenges as well. We might not see that, but that's the reality. And so this hadith is golden. This hadith is very encompassing and golden in advice. Look at those who are below you. Don't keep looking at those who are above you. Otherwise you will show no gratitude to Allah Ta'ala. That's when it comes to the dunya. When it comes to the deen, when it comes to the religion, and when it comes to akhlaq, and when it comes to good things, then you do the other way around. You look at those who are better than you. Yeah? Why? Because when you look at those who are better than you in manners, and those who are praying better than you, and reciting and memorizing the Quran better than you, then you'll think to yourself, I'm not doing enough. I have to do more. And you'll push yourself. But if you look at those who are worse than you in religion, then you will also slack in your religion. If you start smoking and your parents tell you off for smoking, you'll say, well, people are taking drugs out there, Alhamdulillah. Yeah, so be grateful that I'm not taking drugs. That's the wrong way to look at it. Because if you're going to look at people who are below you in the religion or in manners or in goodness, then it won't encourage you to do good. You'll always stay at the bare minimum. But if you look at those who are better than you, then you want to catch up with them and race and challenge them, compete with them. So when it comes to the religion, do we look above or below? Above. And when it comes to the dunya, do we look above or below? Below. Why? So that we can be grateful. So that we can be grateful for what we have. طيب. عن ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا كنتم ثلاثة فلا يتناجى اثنان دون الآخر حتى تختلطوا بالناس. If there are three of you, then two of you should not chat quietly amongst yourselves and leave aside the third person. And this happens a lot at school. Three students together, two of them chat quietly to themselves, or they walk off and the other person's sort of lurking behind, trying to catch up, but they're not really paying attention to the person, and they keep ignoring that person and talking amongst themselves. If there are three of you, then two of you shouldn't talk quietly amongst yourselves and ignore the third. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ says, مِنْ أَجْلِ أَنَّ ذَٰلِكَ يُحْزِنُهُ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. This hadith again is agreed upon in Bukhari and Muslim. Because this will cause him to be upset. This will cause him to be upset. What if there is a group of us like a group here, and two of you go to the side and talk amongst yourselves. Is that acceptable or unacceptable? Why? Because there are many people here, so you're not going to have anyone feel left out. You're not leaving any person out. If we're a large group like this, and all of us go to the side and talk, and we leave one person behind, acceptable or not? Not acceptable, that's even worse. That's even worse than just two people. Thinks this whole army is gone and they've just left me behind as though I don't exist. That's even worse than just two people moving to the side and quietly talking amongst themselves. Okay, what if there are three people? Two are Somali and one is Pakistani. And the two Somalis speak in Somali amongst themselves. But they're still together. They're still sat together and they're still facing each other. And the Pakistani brother is listening as well. Doesn't understand what's being said, but he's there. Is that acceptable or not?
Not acceptable.
Not acceptable. Why? Because it's the same thing. Leaving the person out. Because the Prophet says, بِأَجْلِ أَنَّ ذَلِكَ يُحْزِنُهُ. Because that causes the person sadness. Are these two people always going to be talking about the third person? Not always. You might be talking about something else, you might be talking about something private, you might be talking about something completely unrelated. You might just be more fluent in your language, so you want to talk in your language. Whatever it is, but it doesn't matter. Because the problem is, this person will feel left out. And he may start to think that they're either talking about me, why are they suddenly changing the language? You were talking English a minute ago. Why suddenly you change the language? And so even though you might not be saying anything against the person, but any time we do something that may cause a person to be upset, that comes under this hadith. Anything. And that's really important, because this hadith gives us a principle. لِأَجْلِ أَنَّ ذَٰلِكَ يُحْزِنُ. Because harming and upsetting another person isn't allowed. Whether that's by speaking a language that he doesn't understand, or whether that's done by leaving them out, or any other way. Any comments on that so far? The Prophet ﷺ says in the following hadith, لَا يُقِيمُ الرَّجُلَ مِنْ مَجْلِسِهِ ثُمَّ يَجْلِسُ فِيهِ وَلَكِنْ تَفَسَّحُوا وَتَوَسَّعُوا. Reported by Bukhari and Muslim. None of you should ask someone to leave his place and then sit in his place. You don't ask someone to leave their place. If someone sat in a place, don't ask them to leave and take their place, even if they're younger than you. Some people think, because I'm older, yeah, that's it. Stand up, thank you. Just sit down. That's not acceptable, even if the person is younger than you, even if the person is much younger than you. وَلَكِنْ تَفَسَّحُوا وَتَوَسَّعُوا. But make space. Okay, make space. And in the ayah, Allah Ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ فَفَسَّحُوا. Oh, you who believe, if it is said to you, make space in the gatherings, then make space. يَفْسَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. And Allah will make space for you. Not just physically make space for you. It doesn't mean that Allah will just make space for you in the gathering. Allah will make things easy for you generally, because you're making things easy for those around you. Sometimes you can get upset. Yeah, alhamdulillah, there's quite a bit of space here in the line, and then someone comes along and wants to squeeze in. We were fine here a minute ago, and now you've come and tightened the space. Yeah, if he's tightened up the space a lot, then yes, he's wrong. And some people do that. 3 centimeters, think, yeah, I can fit there. Then that's unacceptable, because now you're making life difficult for everyone else. And I was praying Salat al-Tarawih once at Masjid al-Aman. And the first line was so tight, everyone was facing away from the Qibla. The Qibla is this way, everyone's facing this way. Because it was so tight. And everyone was squeezing the people next to them to the other direction. That's not, how can you focus in Salah when you're being strangled for you know, an hour and a half or an hour and 20 minutes. But if there is space, then make space. Not be tight. Okay, at the same time, it doesn't mean, okay, spread yourself and widen your legs, one leg here, one leg here, and you take up all the space when there's no need for it. Now, there is a fiqhi issue that scholars discuss, and that's the issue of saving the space. And of course, this hadith applies not just to the masjid, it applies elsewhere as well. It applies everywhere. The fuqaha, rahimahullah, discuss the issue of keeping a space for yourself, like some people do in Ramadan. Yeah? They leave a siwak, or they leave their hat, or they leave something, and they go for a couple of hours, come back when it's Taraweeh, and they reclaim their seat. And that's a problem. Because then some people have iftar in the masjid, let's say at 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock, and then only come back at 10:30. And they think that they're entitled to that. And that's not really a good thing. If you're leaving to make wudu and come back, understandable. If you're leaving for a phone call and coming back, understandable. But if you're going to have iftar and have a quick nap and relax and shower and this, and then come back and then still want your seat, that's not really good. And some of the scholars went as far as saying it is haram. Like Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Sa'di, rahimahullah, who considers doing that to be prohibited. And so, if you're there, alhamdulillah. If you wanted to be in the first row, but someone got there before you, zakallah khair, you're rewarded the same. There's nothing to worry about. Okay, yes, it's nice to be in the front row in salah. But if our objective is ajr and reward, then we don't need to go to such extremes too, in order to be in the front row or to be sat in a certain place, and so on. In the following hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لِيُسَلِّمِ الصَّغِيرُ عَلَى الْكَبِيرُ وَالْمَرُ عَلَى الْقَاعِدِ وَالْقَلِيرُ عَلَى الْكَثِيرُ وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ لِمُسْلِمُ وَالرَّاكِبُ عَلَى الْمَاشِي. Now, we said that giving salam is from the rights that all Muslim has upon another Muslim. What's the ruling of giving salam, initiating salam? Remember, we said the rulings are five. Wajib, obligatory, you have to do it. Or mustahab, recommended, you should do it. If you don't do it, it's not haram. Mubah, permissible. Okay, like wearing a hat or wearing socks or not wearing socks. That's mubah. You're not going to get more reward for wearing a hat or wearing socks than not. And then we have makruh, that's the fourth one, disliked. You shouldn't do it. But if you do it, you're not going to be quite sinful, but you shouldn't do it. And the fifth is haram. It's prohibited. And if you do it, you'll be held to account for it. Which of these five is the ruling of giving salam? When you see someone giving salam to him? The second, good. Mustahab, it's recommended. If we say you have to give salam to every person you meet, that's difficult, because then it means if you don't give salam, you're sinful. Which the scholars don't say. But it's recommended. However, responding to the salam is obligatory. You have to respond. And the reason is obvious. If you walk past someone and none of you give salam, then you've missed out on something that is a sunnah, but you haven't harmed anybody. But if someone says Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah and you look at them and just walk off, then you've harmed that person and you've disrespected them also. And this is why responding to salam is wajib. Who should give salam to who? Anyone can give salam to anyone. However, it is better for the following to give salam to the following. He says, the young to the old. If it's someone older than you, then the younger one should give salam to the one who is older first, out of respect for the elder. Then he says, وَالْمَارُ عَلَى الْقَاعِدِ. And the one passing by should give salam to the one who's sitting. If someone sat on a bench on the side and you're walking past, then the one walking past should give salam to the one sitting. Al-Imam al-Maziri from the Imams of the Malikiyya, rahimahullah, says, one of the wisdoms behind this is that when you're sat down and somebody's coming towards you, especially if you don't know them, what might you feel?
Yeah,
you might feel a bit worried or nervous or threatened, because you don't know who this person coming at you is, and he's coming in your direction. Allahu a'lam what's gonna happen. And so because it may cause that worry in a person, it is recommended for the one passing by to give salam first, in order to remove any worry or issue that you might have had. Then he says, وَالْقَلِيلُ عَلَى الْكَثِيرُ. If one person walks in amongst a group, who should give salam first? The one over should give salam to the group. This is not obligatory. If the older one gives salam to the younger one, that's fine. If the group gives salam to the one, that's fine as well. But if we are in any of these categories, then we should give salam first. Okay. In the following hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "La yashrabanna ahadukum qa'im." Akhrajahu Muslim. Very simple hadith.
بالنسبة للسلام هل يجوز يعني الرجل أن يسلم على المرأة؟ يعني دخلنا هنا مثلا دخلت على مكان في رجال وفي نساء قلت السلام عليكم أو دخلت على مكان في فقط نساء تقول السلام عليكم أو لا تقول يعني
نعم that's an important question as well. Giving salam to the opposite gender, a man giving salam to a woman or a woman giving salam to a man. Now there's some discussion amongst the fuqaha. However, generally speaking, if it's giving salam to a group of people who are mixed, men and women, and you give salam to all of them, then there's no issue at all. Similarly, if it's one person and you give salam, a man for example, walks past a group of women and gives salam to a group of women, again, there's no issue. The only slight difference the scholars have, if it's one young man giving salam to one young woman, or the opposite, then some of the scholars say that there's no need to give salam because it may cause the other person to think that this salam was given for a specific intention, for a specific reason, etc. And it can lead to things. So all of this comes down to maslaha. This is not a general rule. All of it comes down to your case. If it's a relative of yours, for example, a cousin or an auntie, or of course the aunt is a mahram, so there's no issue there at all. If it's a person at work, or you're a teacher, or it's your teacher, and they're from the opposite gender, then there's no issue. Yeah, there's no issue, because the maslaha dictates that. But if you think there may be a concern, if you think there might be a concern, then you think twice about this issue. Now,
if you see someone making the dhikr of Allah, should you avoid giving them salam at that point?
Jazakallah khair. That's another good question, and if it wasn't for time, I would have touched upon. And this is another time in which you should not give salam. As the fuqaha rahimahumullah explicitly said, if someone is making dua or someone is reciting the Quran, unless you really need them, then that's another issue. But sometimes you see that a person's in the middle of making dua and someone taps him on the shoulder. Salaam alaikum. Just walks off. Salam, you can delay that salam, give it another time. And if you really want to give them salam because you haven't seen them for a while, etc., wait for them for a minute or so, etc. Because in the middle of dua, now you cut off their dua. They're not going to go back to the and continue dua, making dua properly now. That's not a correct time to make dua. Some scholars also dislike giving salam when entering a gathering of knowledge. And if a teacher is speaking and teaching, and then somebody comes along and says "Assalamu alaikum" loudly, then that's a distraction. It's a distraction. And this is why it is better to attend a gathering if you're late and quietly sit down without causing any distraction. And one of the mashayikh of hadith was in a gathering of hadith teaching, and someone came in and said "Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah." And no one looked at him and no one responded. And they carried on with the class. And he was a bit confused. Was that not loud enough? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah again. And no one looked at him or even slightly looked towards him and continued with their class. Because it was a class of hadith. We're in the middle of talking about the Prophet and his sunnah and his ahadith. It's not time for you to break break that and come in. Especially if it's a large masjid and many people are coming in and out. That means every minute or two someone comes in, salamu alaikum salam. Okay, let me carry on. So, wa alaikum salam. Okay, wa alaikum salam. And then it causes distraction, it causes a disturbance to the class, and it doesn't befit the etiquette of ilm. Some scholars might say something else, they might have a slightly different approach, but this generally goes with the qawa'id. You choose the right time to give salam. Okay, you choose the right time to give salam to a person. Okay. The following hadith, like we said, is the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, لَا يَشْرَبَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ قَائِمًا رَوَاهُ مُسْلِمٍ. None of you should drink while standing. It is better to drink sitting. But the Prophet ﷺ drank standing also, as reported by Muslim. And it's reported by Bukhari rahimahullah that Ali ibn Abi Talib drank standing. He drank standing and said, I saw the Messenger ﷺ do what I've just done. Drink while standing. So it is allowed, it's not haram to drink standing, but it is better to drink while seated. And also in the following hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِذَا تَعَلَى أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَبْدَأْ بِالْيَمِينِ وَإِذَا نَزَعَ فَلْيَبْدَأْ بِالشِّمَالِ. If one of you puts on some clothes, then he should begin with the, which side? The right. And when you take them off, you should begin with the left. And this is a good adab. Some people might think, even putting socks on, I have to think about which sock to put on first. Just let us live normally and put our socks on normally and shoes on normally and don't put so much of a burden on us. And that's a misunderstanding, because if a person is able to be conscious of what they're doing and focused in what they're doing when they're putting their shoes and socks on, then you will make sure that when you do something more important, you will be even more careful. And once one of the shuyukh was teaching about drinking with the right hand, he said it's a sunnah to drink with the right hand and it's disliked to drink with the left hand. So one of the audience said, Sheikh, people are dying in Palestine, yeah? And you're telling us drink with your right hand, don't drink with your left hand. What's going on? He said, if you can't even drink with your right hand, if it's too difficult for you to follow a teaching of drinking with the right hand, then how in the world are you going to go and save the Palestinians or save anyone else who's suffering in the world? If you can't do something as basic as this, you want to take on a whole country on your own. And so this comes because of a lack of thinking and a lack of understanding. We belittle these types of etiquettes. But they're important. Yes, they're not the most important thing in the religion. It's not more important than salah. It's not more important than iman and tawheed and so on. Of course, everything has to be put at the right place. But that doesn't mean that these etiquettes are not important. They're good etiquettes. And the more conscious you are of them, the more it teaches you to be careful, and the more it teaches you to think before you act. And that's why these small actions, don't look at them as though they're useless or not important. They teach us a lot. They teach us discipline. We have only a few ahadith left to end this chapter. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَا يَمْشِي أَحَدُكُمْ فِي نَعْلٍ وَاحِدًا وَلْيُنْعِلْهُمَا جَمِيعًا أَوْ لِيَخْلَعْهُمَا جَمِيعًا مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. None of you should walk with one shoe. Either take them both off or put them both on. And again, this comes from dressing with good akhlaq. And this is why Qadi Iyad rahimahullah says, it is disliked to dress in any odd or strange or excessive way. Every person will look at their own custom, where they're living. If you're dressing in a way that is unbelievably strange, or unbelievably different from everyone else, such that everyone is going to be staring at you, looking at you and thinking, look at that person. If I have a massive afro and colour it, dye it, one side blue and one side pink, is that going to cause a distraction and for people to stare at me. Of course. And that's not really considered normal, is it? No one looks at someone with that type of hairstyle and just walks past and thinks, yeah, that's fine. Absolutely normal. And so this applies to hairstyles, and this applies to clothing, and this applies to even behavior. You look at the place that you're living in, and be normal. Be like everyone else. Don't stand out like a sore thumb. Don't be completely different from everyone. And also be balanced in the way you dress. Okay, be balanced in the way you dress. To walk around with, okay, one sock on and one sock off, and that's, you're not going to be sinful for it. You're not sinful for wearing one sock and taking the other one off. But you're doing something that's odd. And you're doing something that's unnecessary and outside of reasonable and moderate akhlaq. وعن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا ينظر الله إلى من جر ثوبه خيلاء متفق عليه. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah will not look at the one who drags his thobe out of pride. Al-Bukhari and Muslim report this hadith. And in another hadith, مَا أَسْفَلَ مِنَ الْكَعْبَيْنِ مِنَ الْإِزَارِ فَهُوَ فِي النَّارِ. Anything that is below the ankles from your clothing is in the fire. And this hadith shows us that if a person dresses in a certain way, in particular if they drag their thobe or their garment on the floor, if they do that out of arrogance and pride, like people used to, then this becomes prohibited. And there's no difference of opinion amongst the scholars on that. There's no difference of opinion that doing so is haram if you do it out of pride and arrogance. And this is why the recommended when wearing a thobe is for a person to keep it above his ankle. Not too high, but above his ankle. And the majority of scholars say that if your clothing falls below your ankles, but you don't do it out of arrogance or pride, then there's no harm. And that's the madhhab of the majority of the scholars and the former Zahed and the Sheikh Taqiyuddin al-Mutaymiyyah al-Hafid and also a number of the Imams. And that's the case with most people today. When they wear trousers or they wear clothes that are slightly below the ankle, then they don't really mean that out of arrogance. Okay? People aren't going to look at someone who's wearing trousers below their ankle and think, astaghfirullah, he's being arrogant, he's boasting about that. Because these are standard way of dressing. And so, if the illah isn't present, if the illah, the wisdom behind the ruling is not found, then the ruling also doesn't apply. وَالْحُكْمُ يَدُورُ مَعَ عِلَّتِهِ وَجُودٍ وَعَدَمٍ. And so, however, if someone wears other things and dressing in that way is known to be the way of someone who's arrogant or boastful, then you shouldn't do that. Okay? And you can think of your own examples. I don't have to give a specific example. If someone is dressing in a certain way to boast or to be arrogant, then here you have to be careful. Okay? Like someone who wears a brand new suit and tie, and then looks at every person who's not wearing a suit and tie and thinks, poor people, miskeen. They're dressed like, you know, average people, and mashallah, dressed in a respectable, etc., way and so on. So here we have a problem. Here we have a problem because your clothing are causing you to boast and feel arrogant. If it doesn't cause that, then dressing well is a good thing. Islam doesn't say dress in a strange way, dress with your worst clothes, have holes in your clothes to show that you're pious and so. Islam has never said that to us. But Islam has come with being moderate and reasonable. Being moderate and reasonable. And that's all. And this hadith, according to a number of the companions, also applies to women. However, women are given the concession of keeping their clothes till they cover their whole body, including the feet. But that doesn't mean that it's good for them to drag. Even for women, their clothes shouldn't drag. And you might see that a lot, especially in weather like this. It's wet and soaking, it's soaked outside, and then you drag your garment. And then you might enter someone else's house or go into the masjid with a garment that's soaked because you're dragging your clothes. So whether you're a man or a woman, both of that is not recommended. Okay. In the following hadith, and we have two ahadith to go, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِذَا أَكَلَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَأْكُلْ بِيَمِينِهِ وَإِذَا شَرِبَ فَلْيَشْرَبْ بِيَمِينِهِ. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, hey, if one of you drinks, then he should drink with his right. And if he eats, then he should eat with his right. And we spoke about this briefly already. It is recommended to drink with your right and eat with your right. And it is disliked to drink or eat with your left. Okay, that's the general rule. And similarly, drinking with one hand and eating with the other hand is disliked. Firstly, because you're eating too quick. And secondly, because you're then eating or drinking with your left hand. So to eat and drink and eat and drink and eat and drink, like what they do at, what are they called? Competitions. Who can eat the most this competition? Who can eat the most that competition? And I saw on the news not long ago that somebody was trying to break the world record for eating the most number of burgers in 3 minutes. And he ate 10 burgers in 3 minutes. Of course, that type of thing is unacceptable in and of itself, eating that much and that quickly. But even this eating with one hand and drinking with another is problematic. Okay? Or drinking with your left, and then just before you drink, touch it with the right and think, alhamdulillah, it counts as having drunk with the right, which isn't the case. You know, the Prophet said, when you drink, drink with your right, and when you eat, eat with your right. If that means you have to drink, and then put it down, and then pick up the spoon, and then eat again with your right hand, alhamdulillah. No one's running after you and chasing after you to eat within a set time. There's time, inshallah. Yes.
What if you use both hands?
Now, both hands is acceptable. Both hands, if there's a need, is acceptable. Because sometimes eating with one hand can be difficult. If there's a need, that's fine. If there's no need, then the one hand is enough. And again, this comes under akhlaq. Because eating with both hands gives the impression that you're
greedy.
Yani, I didn't want to use that, but it gives the impression that you're too much into the food. And there's no need for that unless there is a reason. Okay? Holding with one hand is difficult or whatever, then there's an excuse. The final hadith of this chapter is the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, كُلْ وَاشْرَبْ وَالْبَسْ وَتَصَدَّقْ فِي غَيْرِ سَرَفٍ وَلَا مَخِيلًا. And the Prophet ﷺ says here, eat and drink and dress, wear your clothes as you wish, and give sadaqah without extravagance or pride. And this encompasses most of what we've just spoken about now. Eating your favorite foods is fine, drinking your favorite drinks is fine, wearing your favorite clothes is fine, but don't go to extremes and don't be arrogant or proud and boast in front of other people. And this hadith is excellently chosen by the author, rahimahullah, to end this chapter, because it summarizes what we've been looking at. Absolutely fine. If you like certain things, some people like certain things. Not everyone likes exactly the same thing. One of the brothers once came to me and he really likes wearing a hat. Those hats with letters on either M or whatever, Y, etc. And he's always wearing a different hat. And I asked him, how many have you got? He said he's got about 30 different hats. He likes those hats. I've never worn one for as long as I can remember. So to me, it might not mean much. But he likes wearing that hat. Do we say it's haram for you to wear it? It's not right for you to wear it? No problem. You can wear anything that you like. Dress in any way that you like, no problem. But be moderate, don't go to extremes, and of course follow the teachings of the Sharia when it comes to dress. And don't boast and look down on other people. That's it. If those guidelines are followed, then there's no harm in eating or drinking or dressing as a person wishes. Sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Jazakallah khair.
Wa iyyak. Any comments before we pack up? Jazakumullahu khair. So next week, inshallah, we'll continue again after Salat al-Isha.